back home and I'm in love.
South of Watford.
Turn down the motorway, heading south. Heavy, heavy eyes, dry to mouth.
South of Watford.
Motorway's coming like a video game at 100 miles an hour. London's calling out my name, can't you feel the fire?
South of Watford.
In the past 5 years, black British dance music has come into its own, with acts like Five Star and Jackie Graham leading the field.
There's no need to be a hero. Don't be ashamed, just play the game. Can't you see? Satisfaction guaranteed.
Part of this music explosion was the birth of the Street Crew, an independent record company operating from this unlikely-looking house in the wilds of Ealing. It deals in every kind of dance music, from funky go-go to smoochy soul.
Got to have some money now. Hey,
but what's really brought in the bucks and given Street Sounds its reputation is its specialist hip-hop electro output. From its humble beginnings in the back streets of the Bronx, hip-hop has emerged as the music of the 80s. But since the cult crossed the Atlantic, it's grown so much that in 1987, London has become the hip-hop capital of the world.
As far as I can see, having been to New York, the only people that are actually into hip-hop in New York are the ones doing it, and there aren't that many people, and consequently you get this constant stream of people coming across, spending a lot of time in London. DJ Cheese, Jazzy Jazz.
Because they're much bigger over here. I mean, everyone loves them. Finally, after 10 years, decided to hit this year. And it's now is the time when it's actually beginning to sell. And suddenly there's all these bands arriving. Like...
London rappers Fission are the latest signing by the man who heads the Street Group. He's Morgan Khan. 4 years ago, Khan realized that there was a market for this kind of music, and it wasn't being exploited by the major record companies. Most hip-hop at the time was only available on expensive import singles, which could cost up to a fiver a go. By licensing tracks and putting them all on a £5 compilation album, Khan reckoned he could get rich quick while doing the kids a favor.
Basically walking into an import store, looking at 8 imports I wanted to buy, then doing a quick mathematical sum, working out I couldn't afford it, and that applied to another X 100,000 kids out there. So I thought, why not put all these imports, all these classy dance tracks on one compilation?
Before you could say breakdance, Khan had the classic entrepreneurial success story on his hands.
We turn around the album from time of getting final track clearance in 4 working days. Our factories, our sleeve manufacturers, our label printers, we have a great relationship with them. They know we aren't like the old-fashioned 3-month pre-production type albums. Let's start working the vocals, yeah?
Yeah.
Backing up, yeah?
As hip-hop became a phenomenon, so too did Khan. His high profile and outspoken conservative views made as much of an impact inside the industry as out there on the streets.
Just leave vocal.
Oh, Morgan lives, eats, sleeps and breathes music, which is great. We need Morgan Khan in this industry.
But there's always got to be music, and he's always involved. And it's like, you got to listen to this. What do you think of this? Oh, don't you think this is great? And he's forever there. Totally hyper music mad.
I don't think you... I mean, if you... spent 2 years going around every single person from the lowliest DJ to the highest echelons of record companies. I don't think you'd find many people that would profess great love for Morgan.
But in spite of this, Morgan refuses to hide his light under a bushel.
Yeah, my question is, would the panel agree that the Labour Party in Britain is a natural party for Asians to join?
Is it, Morgan?
I'm going to be hated again. I'm a staunch Tory supporter.
Give him a chance to speak.
Thank you. I said, I'm a staunch Conservative. I believe that the whole fallacy that the Labour Party is a party of the Asian is a myth that's been carried down from the 50s to the first migrants from the Asian communities. It is not the party of the people. The party of the people is a party that they believe their lifestyles or their futures belong to.
I am honestly proud of the way I am. You know, you can knock me that I'm obnoxious and I'm blasé and I'm arrogant. If I am that, if come the final analysis and on my tombstone I have those three great words, fine.
You're going to formulate the advertising campaigns.
Well, he said it, and many would agree. But Khan has always had a clear vision of what he is and what he's doing, and he's prepared to work his pops off for it.
Unknowns in the studio. The whole thing about the studio is for unknown groups.
Yeah. I mean, Morgan will work 365 days of the year if needed. He will work 24 hours a day. I mean, I've known him to do that. I mean, he'll, you know, I've known him to come into his offices early in the morning, spend the whole day there, spend the whole night in studios, in the evening, go out and visit clubs.
I try not to go for lunch during the week, and people I do need to see for those kind of meetings, because believe it or not, a lot of business is done over meals, I see in the evening. Work through to about 8, 9 in the evening, do some A&R, call Los Angeles, New York, they're like behind us, 5-8 hours. Head for a club once in a while on Wednesday, but Thursday, Friday, Saturday, mandatory club night. I would start at the regional clubs because hick laws being what they are, they'd close much earlier. So I'd maybe start at Flicks in Dartford. I'd hit some of the outside regional clubs, at Cambridge Hotel in Camberley. I then come in towards town, where would I go? Gulliver's. The Beetroot, the Wag, but of course, Limelight, Café de Paris. I also try and hit all the various styles of music clubs.
Tonight, Morgan's talent troll starts at the Wag Club, where some of his latest signings are rapping. Acts like this one are part of Khan's attempt to establish a strong British hip-hop scene.
So with hip-hop, it's not the staid, tired South Bronx, Brooklyn-type sound. It's fresh, it's different, and the New York kids, Miami kids, LA kids are really getting into what we're doing here. It's very exciting. I like selling coals back to Newcastle. It really is, like, 1986, I think, will be a landmark date.
Morgan's tender years were spent in Hong Kong with his Indian father, an airline pilot, his Scottish mother, and older brothers Henry and Richard. When he was 9, Morgan's family moved to England. His early school years were spent as a boarder at a Jesuit-run school, Presentation College, near Reading. At the age of 14, Morgan transferred to an all-boys secondary modern in Kingston-on-Thames. One of his old school reports got it both right and wrong.
Morgan needs to improve his attitude and get down to some hard work. He has far too high an opinion of his own ability and importance. A humbler attitude and the indication of willingness to benefit from advice would help him considerably.
And although his musical ability wasn't exactly outstanding, his desire to play centre stage was in evidence.
And Morgan at the time had a baritone voice. I won't say it was a particularly nice voice, but he wanted to do something. So he brought along the song My Way, which is one of Frank Sinatra's favourites. And we practiced it, and eventually he went through the rehearsals, got on the stage in front of about 400 people, and performed it.
Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do, saw it through without exemption. I've planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way.
Have remembered, you remember now?
Just remembered it.
You remember getting...
After that, everyone thought that Morgan was destined for a career in medicine. But then one night, like Paul on the road to Damascus, he had a vision.
Suddenly, about 10 o'clock in the morning, he comes rushing down. Mom, and he shouted out from above the stairs, Mom, Mom, I've had a fantastic dream. He was so elated and excited, and I didn't know what to expect. You know, dreams are dreams. And he came down, he said, and I've had this dream. I'm going into the music business. I thought to myself, you know, what does he know about music? There's nothing he knows other than playing the radio or the transistor and records and tapes. But he was really changed. He was bubbling. He was full of himself. He's like he is now.
Lest he forget, Morgan scribbled it all down.
I after writing this enormous green file, woke up in the morning, went to my mother's room and said, Mom, I have this dream, blah, 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 blah. She said, fine, Morgan, go back to bed. I literally went back to my room, packed my bags, left, and ended up in a bedsit, like in South London, Lavender Hill to be exact.
Well, that's the official version of the story. You know, street cred and all that. But Morgan's big brother, Richard, and his wife, Liba, remember things rather differently.
We all firmly believed that medicine was going to be his future. And it came as quite a shock, actually, when, you know, when I rang my wife from Pakistan one day, I was on a contract out there, and she said, guess what? You know, Morgan's seen Saturday Night Fever, and it's music.
Khan had seen the light. There was no stopping him now. He was going to make it big in showbiz.
Morgan, you see, it's quite funny because not many people know this, but Morgan started out as a DJ. Now, it's really funny. You see, years and years ago, there was all these little pirate radio stations, and I remember Morgan, right, as a DJ on the radio station, and he probably won't admit this, but he used to call himself Morgan Lovell, which was so funny because that's really part of his personality, you know? Morgan loves all.
Radio Jackie, Southwest London, close enough to care.
And I went on the name of Morgan Lovell. I had a real, like, soft soul show. I used to, like, give these, like, Greg Edwards-type soft soul spiels, like, hey, let's fall in love, and, you know, touch us softly, and all that kind of stuff. It was great. That was fun. That was really good fun. Morgan Lovell. What a great name.
This summer, Radio Jackie presents For Men and Women Round About Town. Radio Jackie T-shirts.
Pirating's okay for small fry, but Morgan was after much bigger fish, and he just didn't have the time.
Pretty sizes.
The demands of Radio Jackie were such that I think at 5:30 on Sunday you'd wake up, set up the transmitters, and start broadcasting, and you know, working Monday through to Saturday, then waking up at 5 in the morning again. It was a little too much, you know. It was it was a great experience because a lot of the people there then have stayed in the business. That was the only reason. Just time, again, time. My whole life seems, unfortunately, to be dominated by the lack of time.
So cover your tanned torso this summer with a Radio Jackie T-shirt. The price is just a mere £2.50.
I sacked him. He turned up. He used to turn up about 5 minutes before his programme was due on air. We were using taped programmes in those days. He'd turn up in a taxi. Well, he was meant to turn up at 9 o'clock in the morning. I think he was on about 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and turn up about 10 to 2. And then one day, I think he turned up at 2:05. So I said, "Now back in your taxi. We don't want to see you anymore." And off he went. I feel
like busting loose. After a few false starts in the record business, Morgan decided to go it alone. Streetwave was born, and together with its compilations offshoot Street Sounds, it became a force to be reckoned with. He's come a long way since those early school days at Presentation College, and having heard of his success, a few of the Jesuit priests who taught him couldn't resist bowling along to the Wag to see just what their former pupil and altar boy was up to.
You must think of it as being a fairly large leap to go from being an altar boy to an entrepreneur in this sort of field.
I think that's putting it mildly.
And what's your reaction to coming to a club like this to see the road that one of your pupils has taken?
It sure is an experience, but it's one I wouldn't like to repeat too often.
And I just wonder, is there any chance of your being tempted onto the dance floor later on this evening to get down?
Yes, there is.
Is there really?
There is, yes. I'd be more than willing, yes.
Excellent.
I rather like dancing, actually.
Brilliant.
As Morgan had discovered, the spirit of hip-hop is an infectious joy. When it comes to taking the limelight, Morgan doesn't really like to be upstaged.
If Morgan can sing and dance, I think he'd actually go out there and perform the music himself instead of running a record company.
And that's just what he did when he performed as lead singer with his own act, Masquerade, as this privately shot footage shows. Like his music, Khan's advertising strategy is also American-inspired.
It's a Crazy Eddie blowout blitz! Crazy Eddie's not playing with a full deck because he's practically giving away TVs, VCRs, microwave ovens, stereo rack systems, video camcorders, anything and everything in home entertainment, and lots of home appliances, too. Remember, we are not undersold, we will not be undersold, we cannot be undersold, and we mean it. It's a Crazy Eddie blowout blitz, and Crazy Eddie's going nuts with his lowest sale prices ever. See Crazy Eddie now, his blowout blitz sale prices are... insane.
Here's Morgan's version.
Listen, check out these three monster albums from Street Sounds. Street Sounds 18, the latest dance tracks around. 12-inch mixes like The Social Club, Holiday Rap, Midnight Star, Jackie Graham, and there's 10 hits and all. For you hip-hop kids, it's Street Sounds Electro 14. Now they've got today's classiest love songs on one album, Slow Jam. Listen, Street Sounds 18, Hip-Hop Electro 14, and Slow Jam, and they're in the shops now.
Well, you can see what he was after anyway. But sometimes aggressive marketing and enthusiasm aren't enough, as Khan discovered to his cost when he tried to launch a new dance weekly magazine, Street Scene.
I felt that the paper had all the right ideas, but it never actually delivered its campaign promises. We still don't know what Five Star's favorite food is, or, you know, the color of David Grant's socks or things like that, which is really what they should have been doing, a teeny bopper paper about black music. That way they'd have made money. But they just took little bits of the other papers that existed and bung them all together and churned it out again, and it just wasn't quite exciting enough. And it never got any advertising because no one wanted to put money into a Morgan Khan venture, which probably speaks reams.
The Street Scene lasted only 6 months. It was an expensive mistake.
I have to be honest about it. A misjudgment because I wasn't a publisher. I should have got outside advice. I'm a great a believer in my gut feeling, I unfortunately made some crucial mistakes with the Street magazine.
I can tell the way you hang your head. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Undaunted, Khan went back and concentrated on the music side of his business. His next ambitious step is to get into Motown.
Has nothing at all to be mine.
Punch in.
Not the American variety. The word is that Khan wants to set up a British version.
I know what Morgan's ambition is, and that is to build a British roster of black artists, the same way as Motown did, the same way as Berry Gordy did in the 60s, with your Stevie Wonders, your Marvin Gaye, your Diana Rosses. Morgan feels the same way as I feel. There's a lot of black British talent in this country, and Morgan wants to develop a stable where he can interfuse artists to make them into big stars.
But for the time being, the backbone of Khan's operations is still his Street Sounds compilations. Morgan keeps his ear to the ground by checking out the record stores as often as he can to stay one jump ahead of his streetwise buyers.
I try to get to the import stores about twice, three times a week, basically staying street, seeing what imports come in, what the kids are flicking through, looking where albums presented, sleeves, bags, it's many things, talking to the kids when they come in, what they're buying, why they're buying them. It's great, you know, it's like total education. You can't learn in your office.
In Khan's Get On Your Bike world, there's no room for sentimentality, just hard work and plain speaking.
I've not fucked anybody, screwed anybody to get where I am. Hustled, yes, but I've never, ever, I can say with my hand on my heart, if I had a heart, say I've got here by screwing somebody else. And if that means I'm a brat, I'm a brat. If someone wants to knock it, fine. There's negative and there's positive out there. To me, 98% of this world are good people. They're the good. They're the silent majority. What pisses me off are that 2% minority, those extremists, those militants. They're the people who unfortunately get voiced on the TV stations, radio, and the newspapers, in those rags, you know? And to me, those are the bad parts of our society. And if they want to knock me, I don't give a shit. I really don't give a shit.
Morgan's own lifestyle is a million miles removed from his record-buying public. He's got a flash car, and home is a couple of acres in the leafy stockbroker belt.
Do you feel at all cut off here from your constituency, the kids in Brixton buying your records? Because, I mean, you go to such lengths to get out to the record shops, right, and clubs and see the kind of people who are buying your records, but then you've got this as well.
So. No, because then I'll be the absolute hypocrite, so to speak. I work. I think I work hard. I think my people work hard. And if at the end of the day, your success can't buy you things that you really want in life, you know, like people watching this show will say, some people might say, shit, you know, he maybe pretends to be for the people, whatever, but I am, you know, I love the kids, but ultimately, I work to have something. I have a nice house, I have a nice car. As you know, I don't drink or smoke.
And that's, that's a big bath. Mm-hmm. Jacuzzi, is it?
Have you ever had try one? Well, on Sundays, when I am totally down, see, believe it or not, I might say to you, I like being alone on Sundays, but by 12 noon, I am so bored and my mind's unreal. I normally call my brother who lives around the corner, or don't call him sometimes, just go around for the free meal.
Thanks.
Morgan's lifestyle can't accommodate a wife and kids, so he relies heavily on his family for support.
I'm really getting my
article.
Oh,
I thought it was a Siberian wolf.
You can't look after yourself and you're going to look after a dog.
No. A Siberian wolf. I'm not having any communists living in my house.
I'm not.
But you've got no fences around your house. So how do you keep your dog in?
Mm.
I can understand that.
Telepathy.
Every postman that walks past
him. Every postman's head bitten off.
The
only thing...
Henry, don't you know the dog will mark his territory?
Yeah. Mark his territory, yes.
The only thing a postman bringing a bill, so what the hell?
For domestic things, does he depend upon you now quite a lot? Do you have him turning up when his fridge is empty?
He still raids the freezer.
Right.
He'll still pop in...
Oh, he eats here.
...without notice, and whatever's in the fridge, The other night, for instance, we went out, came home, Morgan was just leaving. He talked my babysitter into almost...
going out with her.
Going out with him. And in his hand, very expensive tin of beluga caviar, which we'd been saving for a special occasion, several tins of oysters, whatever salt beef I had left in the fridge.
His dinner. I don't know.
And rice crackers.
How he mixed all that together.
And this will happen several times in the month. Yeah.
I mean, are you a patriot?
Am I a patriot? In what sense?
Well, which country would you say you feel most attached to?
Oh, I'm British. I'm British. Yeah, yeah. I'm of Indian heritage, but I am British. And I'm very proud. I am proud of this country. I will never leave. I'll never leave England. I'll never close a company. Or I'll never like set up street sounds abroad as a tax exile. This country's been good to me. The people's been good to me. Hopefully, I can give it back.
Hip-hop made Morgan, but others are getting in on the act. The irony of Morgan's success is that now he will have to hip-hop even faster.
Up Front basically is a dance compilation series based on the same ideology that Morgan has his albums. But the competition between me and Morgan is, to say the least, extremely aggressive, very direct, sometimes blunt, sometimes brash. Sometimes we might say things that we shouldn't say. But unfortunately, business is business, and until those definitions expire, I'll carry on the way I am.
I have some very close friends, I have very good relations, who are honest to me, who call me and say, Morgan, you're an arsehole, why are you doing this? And I, in turn, will call them. But friendship, no, isn't that important.
He's very good at picking up on other people's buzzes and then making everyone think that he originated the idea. He gets very enthusiastic, he's good at selling things, but he's terrible at spotting things. He wouldn't be able to spot a hit if it walked into the office, but if it's already a hit, then he's very good at selling it.
I'm not a martyr on a crusade. I'm a businessman. I love what I do. I love dance music. There's nothing else I do. I think I pay my dues each week, and if people don't accept that, they have the problem.
Yes, it was.